It's my passion to talk about drawing narratives and telling architectural stories. And so I really want to share that experience with you. And this is a major part of the discourse of my practice and also my teaching at Bartlett School of Architecture. I want to lift the roof of that wonderful national building. The interior will be revealed to you like a meat pie with a crust removed. That was the quotation that accompanied Joseph Michael Gandy's watercolor bird's eye view painting of Sir John Soane's Bank of England. The quotation is from a popular novel, Gil Blas, by Alain-René Lesage, in which an airborne devil carries the story's protagonist over the rooftops of a city to expose the human follies below. This is the wonderful watercolor painting, and the things that it's always a topic of speculation and stories, and there are many tales associated with it. The painting is often referred to as the Bank in Ruins. It is a cutaway axonometric, and it imaginatively conflates conventions of the Renaissance aerial cutaway perspective with the ruins of Pompeii to create an ambiguous 18th century Parisian narrative of the building both in ruins or under construction. Sorry, I should have more caffeine before I speak to all of you. I will get all my words correct. The painting began this prophecy of the collapse of the banking industry centuries later. That narrative of the painting bears a very, very close resemblance, an eerie one, to the book Oscar Wilde's The Picture of Dorian Gray. In the novel, the portrait of Dorian would age, fade, and record every sin committed, while Dorian himself remains young and beautiful. So the things that, you know, if we were to look at this, it could be the collapse of the banking industry, while the real one stands proud in physical form in London, in the center of London city. And whereas, just like this one, the representation of it would age. I love narratives that goes with far beyond what one would expect of architecture. And I think it's, for me, it's a really, really important part of my critical thinking. Roland Barthes comments in Introduction to the Structural Analysis of Narratives that narrative is present in every age, in every place, in every society. It begins with the very history of mankind, and there nowhere is nor has been a people without narrative. Caring nothing for the division between good and bad literature, narrative is international, transhistorical, transcultural. It is simply there like life itself. And the thing is that if that's so, then it is also therefore significant that buildings as physical repositories of and monuments to human culture contains narratives beyond their quoted function. So it should not just perform what is labeled on the tin, it should have much more. This is a beautiful plan, I have to say, by Mies van der Rohe of the Barcelona Pavilion. However, in general, the primary form of architectural drawings produced by the majority of professionals in practice still follows the triad system of plan, section, and elevation. While these orthogonal forms of representation are well suited to the task of relaying information for construction or fabrication purposes, they possess no qualitative narratives or phenomenological intelligence. I'm not being disrespectful to Mies van der Rohe, but Robin Evans' point that if anything is described by an architectural plan, it is the nature of human relationships, since the elements whose trace it records, walls, doors, windows, and stairs, are employed first to divide and then selectively to unite inhabited space. And Walter Benjamin goes as far as to say the most essential characteristic of the architectural drawing is that it does not take a pictorial detour. This is one of our plans of that we have done in the office many years ago, albeit, and you compare it with the Mies one. I'm not saying my piece of architecture is as good as the Barcelona Pavilion. Mm-hmm. However, there is a lot of further emotions and embellishment within it. I just want to point that out. Myself and my Bartlett unit pursue an opposing creative and intellectual position in the diverse interpretations of the notion of drawing. For us, the most essential characteristics of architectural drawing is that you must be cultivated with plenty of personal emotions, infusing even the most precise construction drawing with poetic qualities and narrative. Benjamin would probably turn in his grave when we advocate drawings must have the ability to take a pictorial detour, have ambiguity and multiple interpretations. Only then the unorthodox drawing or spatial narratives can be the extraordinary medium of architectural speculations. Just to aid the point, these two are what I call, in traditional terms, worm's eye view, made famous by the architect James Stirling. Can you see my, I hope you can see my cursor.
Yeah.
This one here on the left, it's a drawing from underwater. And this one here is definitely a worm's eye view. You can even see the worms on the side. So, yes, we do take things seriously, but we also do not take it that seriously. So I really, really believe in the unorthodox drawing of spatial narratives can be the extraordinary medium for architectural speculations. One of my favorite architects of all times, and I will introduce you to two of them. One of them is the late John Hayter, the American architect. He believes in eccentric narratives and construct. The eccentric characteristics in our drawings advocates symbiosis of critical thinking and the process of conception and conceptualization of design. The layered nature provides versatility in the imagination of spatial experiences, enabling the complex stories of place, brief, and building to materialize. In my own, i.e. CJ's, speculative narratives, we seek to infuse meaning and symbolism into the built environment, just as John Hayter has done to combine fiction with architecture in these series of sketches here and project. This is called, the project is called Victims. It was done in 1986. Hayter wanted, his task was really about spinning a narrative in which it no longer possible to tell what is being designed, who the inhabitants or the habitat is, the structure or the institution itself. So it was very much blurring, using narrative to blur the brief of reality and concept. I will introduce you to a series of formats or representation that we have employed over many, many years. And one of this was one of the techniques, what I call collage or 2.5-dimension drawings, was published in this book called Short Stories. The background to this was the first time when we were invited to exhibit in the Venice Biennale, we somehow could not afford computers. And what we did was that, you know, to be in a big, such a big show like that, I thought we need to be, to think outside the box. So while everybody at that time was rendering or making the largest model possible, I remember there was a model of Copenhagen in the room that was larger than my entire apartment. So we thought of using this technique called collage, a very old-fashioned analog technique where you cut tiny pieces of paper and put them together. And I coined this phrase 2.5 dimensions. It's not 3D, it's not 2D. And I'll just introduce a couple of projects here. Again, here, narrative plays a large part in the momentum of these projects. We always start with narrative. The narrative, to infuse and clarify also our critical thinking of the project. Here, the project was based on the three little pigs. So, you know, one is never proud that, you know, your reference or your starting point of any narrative has to be highbrow. It could be as simple as three little pigs. I'm sure you were told this story when you were aged, you know, one or two. I was a bit of a late starter. I was told this story at about age five. So there you go. And here, I'm not going to go into great detail of the project, but I want to point out to you that, you know, this is also a moment that you can actually blur the boundary between the source and the creation. Here you can actually see at the bottom here. Can somebody give me an indication that you can see my cursor moving, please?
Yeah, we can see it, CJ. We've got it.
Okay, great. Just because otherwise I'll be pointing to things that you can't see. Great. You can see my three little pigs here in amongst the garden of apple scent. Not apple trees, but apple scent. The project is the nocturnal tower for the meatpacking workers in central London at Spitalfields Market. And so the 500 species of apples that we have on these islands called Brijals are packaged into little pockets within the landscape, and it would secrete and cover up the smell of fatality of meat and so forth. We really were very keen in create these sort of pop-up books that really speaks about each segment of the architectural prescription of programs and function, but also to infuse the original source narrative into it. And we wanted it to be almost like a pop-up recipe book. Other projects within short stories was this one here, where we propose a sky transport system across London. And instead of using a known book, I base it on my own story, where, you know, in my childhood days, we were, at least where I come from, I originated from a tiny, tiny village in Malaysia, and the only source of sort of entertainment was the cinema that comes once a week. And so I used to believe in all these sort of dragons and swordsmen and swordwomen that fight at demons and enemies. And so here, the dragon is no longer the evil one. The dragon is the sustainable transport system where all the commuters will have to row this dragon boat across the skyline of London. And while they do so, they would experience a very different landscape, mm-hmm. From peering into all the windows of high-rise office blocks and apartments to billboards, and even encounter the odd sort of puffy cloud. And so there's a flat surface to this drawing, just to illustrate a little bit. and the pieces of paper were cut meticulously and then placed onto it. So we don't cut up books or magazine. We actually just take scans of it or download it and then print it and manipulate it first before printing, and you could print it on opaque papers, cartridge paper, even tracing paper. For example, the clouds are made of many, many layers of tracing paper. And so this is a very simple way of what I call sampling. Just like people in the music industry, they would do music sampling. Here you can sample. And for me, collage takes advantage of the medium's inherent polarity. Pieces of a collage or assemblage are only ever half assumed into their new context, bringing with them a wealth of control and concocted meaning from the original time and place. We usually expect objects to exist in a singular location, but the elements here in the collage or the assemblage oscillate between existences like the Schrodinger cat, presenting a flexible vessel in which the reader is encouraged to deposit their own historical and cultural montage. This is not quite a collage, but it has the intellectual creativity of a collage. This is a painting by Charles Robert Cockerell. It was done in 1838. This is an imaginary skyline of London, and it's called a tribute to Sir Christopher Wren, the great architect. The romanticized painting depicted over 55 of Wren's buildings in London, as well as Chichester Cathedral, Winchester Palace, and All Souls, Oxford. As demonstrated, architectural drawings are not merely a means to an end. It's a vehicle by which information is transmitted, but is a celebration of his speculation and propositional power in the conceptual development of a project and generation of forms. So here, Cockerell put all or as many of Wren's buildings together, even though they're not in London, and to create this kind of tribute skyline. Yes, Wren did do a lot of buildings in London, but they were not in the exact same position. And his most famous building, St. Paul's Cathedral, in a way is big, but it's set right at the back as this mythical, godly building manifestation, sort of almost non-physical. And it gives it that aura of greatness. And so I think, you know, this is always a painting that I like to show my students, at least, that depth in composition and clarity of thought, of concept, of each drawing is very important. And drawings need not be just literal. I'm going to introduce to you also a little bit of our interest in storytelling in a different format, no longer the singular drawing or the singular collage, 2.5 dimensions. We have been fascinated with comics as a form of telling an architectural story. Here, we all know that the long history between comics and the city has enduringly shaped our perceptions of culture, society, and political patterns. This drawing here, this comic, or a fragment of a comic, it was published in 1895 in a magazine called New York World. The Yellow Kid comic strip illustrated street scenes with background descriptions, subtly offering social commentary on New York street life. In England, William Hogarth and later Heath Robinson had the same influence when their drawings appeared in newspapers and magazines. Both these drawings are by the cartoonist cartoonist, illustrator, Heath Robinson. So Hayden would be my number one. I think this is, Heath Robinson is also my number one. I'm their number one fan. While Heath was never an architect, many of his illustrations has enormous spatial qualities and very inventive one for that matter. If you look at this drawing here on the right hand side, this is a section of an apartment block where the people above were having a party and they were worried about disturbing the neighbor below. So they have sponge in their feet, a mattress and pillows to insulate the sound. And the music is all played via this sort of chandelier system. I think what was also quite, I found, you know, humorous and witty and have been very inspired by Robinson's work is because his social commentary, as you can see on the left-hand side, are never cruel, evil, or even acerbic. They were just pure tongue-in-cheek, as we would say in England. This is one that depicts the unfortunate event called World War II between England and Germany. Here is an example of a drawing done by Archigram. I'm sure all of you are familiar with Archigram. Archigram reinvented architecture for the age of the consumer by using bold comic language with speech bubbles enriched with references to graphic narratives. And they were the masters where the power and the poetry of the words are absolutely embedded into the tectonic descriptions. In DC comic, Batman Death by Design, it features a narcissistic genius, a master builder named Kemp Roomhouse. I'm sure you can get who that person is they're referring to. It is a cautionary tale of corruption and architectural hubris, highlighting the detrimental effects on civic culture of architectural destruction in Gotham City, that cautionary tale could equally be applied to any city in this world, anywhere. The other side is a book by Melanie van der Horn called Bricks and Balloons, and it was a whole sort of thesis on various forms of comic. And what was really interesting is that Melanie said and recognizes the ability of comics to question contemporary society, often dismissed as a light-footed, low-threshold form of amusement. But perhaps it's exactly for this reason that comics functions as a wolf in sheep's clothing, bringing serious and critical remarks in an unobtrusive and not offending way. These are a few comics that we produce over the many years. This one was for actually a competition, a Japanese competition, and it described the kind of the day in the life of this projectionist. It was all about the celebration of film and storytelling, the competition, or something like that. It was such a long time ago. But what I wanted to show you is the kind of the clarity that one could produce that, and also the unraveling of spaces and spatial experiences that a single frame might not be able to do. Yes, some of them can do it, but sometimes it might be a bit difficult. So here you can also zoom in and out of focus, of scale. You can take different perspectives, and yet each frame has only a very, very simple and limited amount of information, knowledge, and narrative. And this was our one of the pages of our entry for the Museum of Comics in New York many years ago. And so we really went to town and we greatly enjoyed the whole experience of conceptualizing a space to celebrate comics, but also just literally drawing it out. I'm going to introduce you to another book now. Beth mentioned earlier, Food City, and drawings in there. So the main case study in Food City is this project called the Food Parliament. And it is a satire, a caricature of the real human figures that we have in our House of Parliament. Again, I'm not going to go into in-depth of the project, but I just want to use this to show you how our drawings also have changed over time. For me, I think it's really, really important that I don't have an intellectual answer for it or something clever to say to you, but it has to be horses for courses. And the thing is that, you know, each project takes on different forms and formats of representation, and it has to enrich the whole architectural understanding of the project first and foremost, and then the rest will come. And here we just adopted a very clean, clear system, and we also approach it from a kind of postery sort of, it oscillates between propaganda to clean, clear line drawings. Because the clean line drawings was also criticism about the kind of ambiguity and uncertainty and bullshit that Parliament gives out from time to time. So we started with a series of almost comic strip again. Here you can see them by the numbers, number one, two, and then, you know, of course we added some out for, you know, I didn't put all of them in. So you can see the kind of the approach that's a Food Parliament there, and the whole project is seen through the eyes of the sort of insects that approaches it, and it illustrates the whole journey through the various encounters with each of the tectonic element within the Parliament itself, and each tectonic element performs a very different function.
And CJ, sorry to interrupt you, CJ, these are actually done quite early on in the process for you, aren't they? So these are drawings that I just wanted to point this out, because this is kind of where the students are at the moment, is sketching these thumbnail storyboards of their intentions. Yeah. And these become studies that turn into the final works for you, yeah?
Yes, absolutely. They were the original storyboards. So things that, you know, a lot of times, I mean, forgive me for sounding pretentious, but the things that we try to work like cinematographer or a film director or script writer, where you actually storyboard out your thoughts. And some of the architecture or the tectonic shapes that you draw to illustrate the kind of the architectural narrative might not manifest in the final analysis, but the things that it gives you a framework to really settle your thoughts, but also make you make design decisions early on, or at least understand the parameters of what you're dealing with. And then there are little notes on the side here, on the right hand side, that that further sort of illustrate our thoughts. Because the things that, although we work a lot of drawings, we also write a lot, and the things that text is a very, very important part, as you can imagine, because we deal with narratives and stories. Text plays a very important part in our thinking of designing. No, it was a really excellent question, Beth. Thank you. And we have a lot of these sketches. I'm only going to show you a handful here. So. And some of these manifest itself into the final design, and some of them didn't. And this was the final version of it. That you can recognize some of the tectonic forms and the spatial investigation from the early sketches and the storyboarding. So if this is the top view, the foot pattern basically is a construct that sits above the existing city of London. It doesn't sit on the ground. And this is the top view, and the pyramidal constructs are structures, greenhouses for growing. And then this is a view from the street looking up. And I think, you know, even a street view could be fun. So we sort of thought that it would be quite fun to that lots of tourists will be taking photographs of this construct, hence the hand and the little camera on the right hand side. The subsequent drawings here shows the relationship between each of the tectonic characters within Parliament itself. And for example, this drawing here is the Speaker of the House, which basically controls the kind of the chaos and the arguments that happen in the House of Parliament, which sprays water onto those who misbehave. And here you can see that the drawing has almost three scales to it. This one here is the whole construct that floats above London. And then that, and amongst that bit, there is this construct here, which is the what I call Mrs. Speaker, the watering device, the watering tectonic that has these sort of antennae that comes out. And then at another scale is the plants that it would be watering, or the vegetation they would be watering. So you can actually even combine different scales of information into one drawing if you're, you know, you have to be quite precise about it and not try to fudge it, but to keep it quite clear. Or here, we try to show the kind of, on the right-hand side here, we try to show the groups of the pyramidal structure. And then within this, we then zoom in to show another aspect of it, what happens when it rains, or you can use the zoom in to look into further detail, a cutaway section, or other forms. We have done a lot of these sort of what I call flat-on drawings, for example, like the one on the right-hand side, because I really quite enjoy it, the simplicity of that. I did not invent it, unfortunately. Architects like Arata Ozaki have used it a lot in his representation, and a lot of 60s and 70s architects have also done a lot of that, where you just have a straight projection. One of the most famous ones was used by Rem Koolhaas or OMA in the Lavillette drawing, the famous Lavillette sort of flat on elevation plan that I've done. My inspiration was also from a children's book called Mitzi's World. I don't know if any of you have come across it. So that's where also you can find a lot of incredibly ingenious and very simple and clear way of telling stories. So if you find an old man sitting in a corner in a bookshop reading children's book, please do not call the police. That's probably me getting inspiration from children's books. I think, you know, even when you do perspectives, you can embellish and exaggerate the kind of the poetics of spatial occupation. So here we're looking into the fish farming section of the Parliament, and also, you know, that there must be, with all drawings, it doesn't matter if it's a straightforward octagonal drawing or a perspective or a sort of distorted one like this one, there must be hierarchy in terms of what you shade in, what you color in, and what you leave blank so that you can create depth. This is a food Parliament sitting here right above that Mr. Speaker hovering there, and this was just trying to give it a sense of scale and reality. How are we all doing? Are we all good? Okay, are you still here, all of you? Just say something, somebody shout out, anybody.
Yeah, yes.
We're all here.
Good, good, good. Okay, I hope you enjoy, because I do understand that, you know, this, I hope you don't mind sitting through such a long session with me. I promise you, after this, we'll have a 10-minute break. You can make a coffee or tea or have dinner. Is it dinner time for you?
So, not yet. Go.
In a little bit.
Oh, right, okay. So I'm going to introduce fragments from this other book called Inhabitable Infrastructure. And this was the moment when we were also very interested in how we address, not fight, but embrace climate change, sea level rise in particular, and how we can use and employ science fiction to really liberate us architects and planners about how we can maybe have alternatives to building these bloody mega structures. In London, for example, we're building the second barrier, Thames barrier, to stop the water from coming in. And, you know, rather than actually looking into alternative methods, which is to embrace sea level rise rather than to fight it. So one of the projects in there is this one. It's what I call the thousand fish that goes out to threatened low-lying islands around the world. And this is an all-in-one construct. I guess it's a little bit inspired, I hope, you know. It's inspired by Ron Heron's Walking City. Mm-hmm. This one is not walking, this is swimming. And I hope it's, you know, Ron would not think that it's too shoddy a piece that was inspired by his incredible work. But here, the construct would have everything, mainly fresh water, to take out to these places that are threatened by or already sort of encountering sea level rise. Fresh water is always one, although they're surrounded by water, the water around them are either contaminated or salty that you cannot drink. And most sort of climate change refugees, the first thing they ask for is fresh water. And within that, the structure could also unfold to, as you can see, this is where they arrive in this kind of armada form, and then they will unfold to create a new landscape, a floating landscape for cultivation of food and so forth. So these are sort of drawings that was done sort of almost from a very sort of industrial or sort of military-like emotions that was placed into it. And this shows, you know, a very military ambience. Whereas when this harsh military ambience is then turned into this sustainable, resilient garden for survival. Similarly here, this was the project that looked into sea level rise in Denmark, in Copenhagen in particular. It's very low-lying. Denmark is almost flat. And here we were looking into how these swans structure, what we call, would deflect light back into the atmosphere so that it would stop Greenland from melting. Greenland, as we all know, is melting very, very, very fast. Chunks of it is coming off daily. This is a view if you are the driver of one of the Android swans. It's the wings that deflect the sunlight back into the atmosphere. So we have it from different perspectives. these drawings here are done with that is not a one render. None of our drawings are rendered. Just to be clear, we have a very simple wireframe in some bits. Some parts are rendered separately on separate models, and then we collage onto it. So the way we design and think and construct our drawings are very much layered, and it stems back to the collage, the 2.5 dimensions technique that I introduced earlier on in the very beginning, where you can, you know, in the collage, the 2.5 dimensions, you can actually apply, you don't like it, you can take it off, and you know, and you can stick something back onto it, and so forth. And here with Photoshop, you can do the same thing. So instead of something physical that you can touch, you can do it in the same sort of collage layering technique in terms of not just representation, but also thinking about how new tectonic elements could be applied to your site as well. And this is not a one button press and hey presto, it comes out as one drawing. So they are all different components put together. Also, it saves a lot of memory on your computer. And the hatching and the rendering, you can't see it in detail, but the things that it's a lot of hatching, and the hatching are not the computer ones, but they are actually hand sort of hatch, then scan, and then Photoshop onto it. Mm-hmm. You don't do one layer of hatching, you do multiple layers of hatching. If you look closer, what we're trying to achieve was the kind of paramnesia kind of hatching, drawing, etching quality. So this drawing here is double A0 size. So it's pretty, pretty big. And it's unfortunate in this bloody pandemic that we cannot see anything close up or in reality. We have to see everything from a far, far away distance. So that was the hatching was very much also influenced by the kind of the technique of etching and sort of the Peronesian technique. I think you could see similarities now. I purposely showed this because we are also trying to convey messages, and there's none better than using sort of, looking back at these propaganda, communist, Mao era, during Mao's regime, they produced a lot of these propaganda posters of, well-being and happiness, whatever it is, albeit sort of like, I'm sure it wasn't quite true. And I say that respectfully to Mao. And the thing is that, it was, these posters were very, very powerful. And Mao actually said that the widespread effect of propaganda posters on peasants was akin to a population where everybody has been through political school. And probably it's true, because what I love about these posters were that not so much the propaganda itself, but the clarity, the simple message of, some of these, this one has a whole line of text on there, but, there's usually very few words, and they are very, very powerful to suggest, prosperity and well-being in amongst citizens in China at that time. And so, the other sort of images that we also draw inspiration from are also the Russian constructivist posters too. They were also very, very powerful and very simple in its construct. And some of them, this is a multicolor version, but there are also posters which are much more limited in the color palette. I think our propaganda, we would like it to be less scary in many ways. This is a fairly new drawing that we have done in a series. it's one that really want to convey the urgency of how we are all polluting our ocean. And, you know, there's no way of going back, you know, if we destroy it any further. And instead of scaring people into doing it, we want to encourage, the drawings were done to encourage a younger generation. It has a really childlike quality that convey, to attempt to convey the message that this is all very, very bad. And I think, you know, for many now, we believe that, you know, for many years now, we believe that any change in our habits, mindset about polluting our environments or about climate change has to start at a very young age. So hence, you know, because I think people as old as me, who is 125, is way beyond redemption. We cannot go back anymore. So the things that, you know, we have to educate the younger generation in all our sort of constructs and messages. So this is one that about sort of plastic bags, you know, plastics going into the ocean itself. The ultimate architectural representation need not be a neutral tool or mere picture of a future building. That drawings have a different influence on the conceptual development of a project and the generation of form, and that there are alternatives to the reductive working methods of contemporary architectural practice. Whether it's a stop frame animation, a propaganda comic, or simply a single frame collage, hopefully the heart of an architectural narrative is where we discover the true potential of our human condition. At the same time, the politicisation of architecture through visual storytelling engenders a sense of optimism to reappraise design futures, even impossible ideas to address the world in crisis. After all, dissemination of knowledge through storytelling is an act of kindness. So I think, you know, in this world, we need to think about, as designers, we have, I think in my books anyway, we have an obligation to still be generous and be kind in the way that we operate. And the architecture we dream up must be various diverse forms of kindness, not just to nature and environment, but also to fellow human beings. And I think that's a very, very important part of it, what our future, design futures should embody and embrace. I think at that point, I'm going to stop. I think I've already eaten into your 10 minutes, but don't worry. I won't take questions at this moment. So please take note of what you want to ask me from this section. And then we will do all the questions and answer in the last third hour. You know, so have a break, come back, and in 10 minutes time. So at
10 past 6 over here, guys.
Okay, 10 past 6. Come back, and then I will be showing you the discussion on my students' work, and I will be showing you 3 of the latest ones.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
Thanks, CJ.
Great.
Have a nice coffee break. We'll see you again shortly.
Yeah, in 9 minutes now.
Okay. Counting down.
Are we all back?
Yeah.
Should we give it a couple more minutes?
No.
I think we can begin. I think everybody.
We can begin? Okay, cool. Yeah. Right. As I said, you know, I want this session, I mean, to have 3 hours of your precious time. I'm very, very honored. And so I want to make it as a bit more interactive than me just banging on for 3 hours and, you know, talking. And I want to introduce the Instagram thing so that you can play a little bit. And then if you get bored, you can look at the amazing drawings of some of the drawing, you know. So if you could actually subscribe to this address, and then I would like you to choose also, you know, to select projects that you want me to talk about also from there.
CJ, we've lost your screen share, so they can't see the handle.
Ah, okay. I'll do it again. Can you see it now?
Yes, thank you.
Yeah. So if we can quickly, you know, just if you haven't done so, I'll just give you a minute to do that, because I would like you to scroll through it and then maybe shout out and say, okay, could you talk about this drawing or this project or anything like that? I just want this session to be quite interactive. Otherwise, you know, it's very demanding to just sit and listen for 3 hours. I guess I can start, yeah? This session here, for the next 50 minutes or so, I would like to introduce you to my students' work. I have been teaching at the Bartlett for over, oh God, I just think just on the cusp of 30 years. 30 years is probably twice your age, or most of you there, and probably the same age as your great-grandparents. And the things that, you know, that's fine. and over the course of my teachings, just like my own work, the thinking, my critical thinking, and my ways of representation has obviously changed and evolved. I'm actually a little bit embarrassed of even showing Beth's favorite project of mine, which was such a long time ago. You know, that's when I didn't have a shred of gray hair, and now it's all full of it. And so I think it's really important that we also evolve our design thinking, our critical thinking as time goes by, and also how we adapt and question and interrogate the current situation, you know, at the everyday life. I would like to start with the latest work from my unit first. Remember, just to give you a little bit of context, we have been doing these sort of big propaganda as poster-like drawings for a couple of years now, although the theme and the technique evolve and change. Because of this pandemic, the school was locked down from March onwards. So, and they were to complete their work by May, early June. So suddenly they were asked to change the modes of operation completely. And, you know, I always said that, you know, never waste a crisis, or rather Churchill said that. And so we really thought how we could actually be more engaging in the way that we tell stories. So the things that, you know, we started doing very simple animations, because I'm not keen on sort of big full-on press button, it renders kind of animation. So we went back to two formats of representation or inspiration for the representation. One was to look at old silent movies where you have the moving picture and then you have the text, a very simple sentence, and then moving picture and then simple sentence again as a portfolio. Mm-hmm. Because the students at Bartlett were not allowed to present live online their work, their graduation work. They were only asked to submit a document. The document could be in any format. So there was no interaction whatsoever. And so the document has to be absolutely explicitly clear, the intention, the critical thinking, and all the expressions. The other thing was that when we did animations, we were more interested in stop frame, old-fashioned animation that Wes Anderson would do in his films. I'm sure you're familiar with Wes Anderson. I mean, he's one of the geniuses of the film world. And I love the simplicity of it. And also the kind of old-fashioned 25 frames Disney, when Disney made Mickey Mouse and Snow White and all those great classics. So it's not the kind of Pixar sort of, you know, that uses up incredible lot of RAM and memory, but it's a 25 frame sort of animation. So I'm going to show you, without further ado, I'm going to show you three projects. One is by Edmund Tan, and he was awarded the best year five, which is the graduation year, the master's year, best portfolio. And I'm going to skip bits of it as well, because otherwise we'll be here for a long time. So I would like to show you the whole story. Am I sharing screen or not? No.
No, not yet.
Okay, so I'm going to put my share on. Yep.
Now it's working.
Is sharing screen?
Yes.
Okay, great. Yeah, you can see my screen and hear me?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yep. Okay, cool. Takes inspiration from the film Wall-E. It's a critique and a reassessment, a revisit to Thomas Cole's The Arcadian or Pastoral State, and also takes inspiration from the book The World Without Us. And this is how he laid it out really clearly, the issues that he was exploring, but also he has three chapters in his portfolio. And each chapter has a different color coding.
The downfall of New York. The mega conglomerate corporation, by and large, B&L, assumed control of the planet's entire economy by giving the entire population on Earth the right to spend. Humanity went into a state of mass consumerism. The consumer-driven society produces large amounts of waste, quickly covering the planet in building-sized quantities of trash. According to the World Bank, the US produces the highest amount of trash per day.
Also notice that he incorporates his research and factual data into the narrative as well, rather than saying, this is my project, this is my research and investigation early on. You know, there were not two sections. He seamlessly incorporated in all into the narrative.
Looking further into the country, New York is found to be the most wasteful city in terms of water, energy, and municipal solid waste. An average New Yorker produces 25 pounds of trash weekly. Day by day, the accumulated trash fills up the entire city. Within New York City, Manhattan has the dirtiest and most polluted air quality. The pollution accelerates climate change, which causes frequent acid rain, spontaneous sandstorm, and smog that filled the entire city. Earth was suffering immense pollution from waste and toxification. The operation was broadcasted all over the world. The plan was to evacuate humans from Earth to space in a fleet of luxury starlight. Hearing the news, the humans left Earth immediately, and the Wall-E, waste location load leader, Earth-class robot, starts to clean up the mess. The waste location units will try their very best to mend the mistakes that were left behind by the humans. On the planet, Chapter 1, 2105 AD, The Degradation of New York. Humans have left the planet Earth due to its uninhabitable state. Before initiating Operation Cleanup, the Wall-Es gathered together to discuss the reboot process. After searching their pre-installed archive of historical architectural evolution, they shortlisted three styles for its respective stages. While Wall-E was cleaning the streets, a dollar bill flew into its eye. One of the crests shows the Eye of Providence, which resembled a pyramid. The motto below it signifies the beginning of the new American era. He quickly showed it to his friends, showing them that the trash cubes could be stacked into a form of a pyramid. The last two pyramids would be stacked within the urban voice of Manhattan, as it is the only vacant space left. Reconfiguring landscape with trash isn't something new to Manhattan. Lower Manhattan was once expanded significantly from excavated waste. While E compacts garbages into cubes with his built-in mechanism, the trash blocks will be stacked based on its biodegradability to ensure the stability of the structure. The pyramids will slowly reconfigure the landscape of Manhattan. Day 2. Without humans to maintain the city, the New York City subway started flooding. While the wallies were happily working away, they were hit by a sandstorm. To prevent further casualties, they decided to build a home for themselves. Wallies' new house will be located within the optimum sunlight zone on top of the landfill pyramids. One of Wallies' quirks is his obsession of collecting. The new homes provide a storage space for them to store all of their favorite objects. The Wallie house becomes a safe haven for the hardworking robots. They could play their favorite arcade game Pong in the middle compartment and sunbathe on the upper part of the building. The Wallie could also watch and dance along to their favorite musical, Hello Dolly. Day 10. Bodegas in New York started filling up with a stench of pungent smell from the rotten foods, which attracted all kinds of vermin. Well, historians say that the god Ra often took the form of a cat, and people began associating it with feline longevity. Because of this, Wally adopted the cat as a symbol of longevity for the city. To show his gratitude, Wally decided to build a home for the felines, converting steel skyscrapers by using his built-in laser into a form of a cat. Wally began to map out the 100 tallest building in Manhattan and highlighting the steel towers for the cats. They also began to study the structure of the steel skyscrapers in order to initiate the conversion process. The steel skyscrapers pierced through the sky in Midtown and Lower Manhattan. The leftover steel beams from the cat towers will be reused in other tectonics. The hardworking Wall-E and the cats worked happily together to reconfigure the landscape of Manhattan. 50 years. Throughout the years, rainwater started filling up gutters of skyscrapers. Rust layers started to form on top of unmaintained structural steel by atmospheric corrosion.
Picking up the floating trash above the streets. As it
materials. Plants started withering. Boys started dying. They began their search for buildings that are made out of limestone. Using solid objects such as lampposts and bus stop signs, they constructed a limestone crusher, which would powderize any stone column. The limestone would be crushed in a series of steps. Once powderized, the spreader will distribute the lime evenly across the topsoil of the pyramid. Together, Polly and the cats will begin to collect found objects to heal the planet Earth. The immense amount of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere causes a shift in climate. To heal the Earth, Polly and the cats agreed to use geoengineering techniques to capture, inspired by their research. The WOE starts to build their own carbon capture devices by using billboard structures and steel railings. The carbon capture trees will be installed along the plastic bottle bridge, which will absorb any prevailing carbon that goes through it. The robots also designed a cloud brightener. Its primary function is to spread salt across the troposphere to increase the cloud's albedo. The cloud brightener will set out on the grid throughout the city. Once it reaches the troposphere, WALL-E will begin to spray a huge amount of salt into the sky. The WALL-Es will also build an energy harvester that gathers wind and solar power, so that they could perform complex and energy-intensive tasks. The healing process begins. WALL-E and the cats will do their very best to turn the planet into paradise. Due to acid rain and sea level rise, WOE lost some of their friends. To commemorate the fallen WOEs, they decided to build a memorial park along the coast of Manhattan. The memorial park is made up of PVC pipes, which will also serve as a tree guard for the afforestation stage. Amongst the roots and shorelines. Facade of the skyscrapers are blooming with dandelions. Malaminid and kudzu grows within the gibbon cage of the bridges, while water chestnuts started to cover the surface of the sea. While the plants are growing throughout New York, the WOE started to build the landing platform for the Starliner by converting dandelions into natural rubber from the cat towers. The natural rubber will be made into rubber fenders, which will become a shock absorbent for the landing platform. Once Eve is satisfied with the process, she flew to the Starliner to inform the humans. Eve arrives at the Starliner and triggers the holodetector in order to initiate Operation Recolonize. Once triggered, within 10 seconds, the ship blasts back in. The humans came out and got their first breath of fresh air for the first time in 7 centuries. The excited humans exited the ship and slowly make their way to the arrival hall. Due to the lack of exercise and overconsumption of liquefied food, the humans have trouble walking. In order, cable steel construction is used to build the arrival belt to ensure all static horizontal forces of the belt are balanced. Slowly, the humans will reach the arrival hall, where they will be greeted by cats. The humans will receive a goodie bags of essential items. After receiving the goods, they will be brought to their homes in a solar-powered water bus. The 15 water bus stations across Manhattan also serve as a timber depot that distributes materials to various households. Soon, the humans arrive to their new home. Each housing unit are constructed within a massive timber framework which allows flexibility of expansion. Instead of letting the humans build everything from scratch, a pre-built home is built by WOEs to reduce the stress level, which allows the humans to adjust to the foreign environment. 10 materials to be harvested in the inner mangrove belt. For each tree harvested, a seedling is planted. The mangroves will then be sent to Wai to be fabricated into a kit of parts. Before landing onto Earth, the Star Anna's captain fantasized on growing a pizza plant. To fulfill his dream, circular farms that are shaped like pizzas were built. The farm will be operated manually by humans to keep them fit. The outcome, by growing food locally, the humans will create a sustainable food chain which will benefit the environment and its surrounding ecosystem. Besides the pizza farm, crops such as rice are grown above the pyramid in Central Park. Beans are grown around the frame of the housing, while potatoes and cabbage are grown in the pocket gardens. Bees will become the main pollinator for the city to ensure ecological survival throughout the city. To prevent the humans from making the same mistakes again, they will be educated in recycling. Waste will be recovered in the center of excellence to build. Crops harvested by the humans will be stored in the Starliner, which has now been repurposed as the food bank. The arrival platform will become the city's new marketplace, and the ultimate leisure activity in Arcadia is fishing, as with Huckleberry Finn.
That's the first one. I'll show you another one now. This is Karen Sang's project. Again, I will be skipping through it. I just want you to take note that the narration here is
the
from...
The following stories, please note that...
She's doing it from the first person point of view. So it becomes a very emotional and personal story.
The following stories, please note that I have highlighted the most important image on each page with red line for your easy reference. Welcome to my story of self-resilience and empowerment. I'm Alika. I was born and raised in Greenland in 2075. This is a photo of my family. I'm the girl on the third line. Standing next to me was my abusive husband, Pavia. I haven't seen him for a long time. This is the simulated impact of sea level rise in Odense, including the flooded historical town center. Anticipating the sea level rise, the city center is preserved by a thick layer of sheet piling from flooding, with a new floating aquatic settlements plant. This is where I live now. The aquatic settlements floating on top of the flooded sites in Odense, after the sea level has risen to 9 meters, we, the Greenlandic woman, inspired by the two weavers in Hans Christian Andersen's tale, The Emperor's New Clothes, saw a window of opportunity for self-resilience and equality here in Odense. Hence, my new chapter in life began. On a sunny day in September, I left my hometown alone for the very first time, with a strong determination to save my family and the world. I'm going to be a new woman. My husband has been physically abusive to me and my twin children over the years, but I had no one to go to. But now, I have an opportunity to change my fate. In preparation of the sea level rise, the Danes recycle a large number of old warehouses, reinterpreting Andersen's characters as architectural symbols by Lego. Influences of Lego can be seen in different levels of details. The reason why the old town is to be conserved is because it is where the important buildings associated with Andersen's childhood are located. He is the famous writer born and raised in the town of Odense in 1805. Landmarks like the city hall, his childhood homes, are all located at the town center. After locating all the important buildings, we are to secure reusable warehouses, which are commonly found along the canal, as underwater communication and space, where the floating communities will be anchored upon them. An overview of the site analysis. Andersen's fairy tale have informed the master planning and tectonic design of the project. The planning of the residential communities is influenced by the characters from fairy tales like the storks, the ugly ducklings, and the ice queen. The project is also very seasonal, as the fields are ice manufacturing and pig farms in winter. While in summer, the ice farms are transformed into organic crops growing. Some floating fields in green can be seen scattered between communities. The Little Mermaid, the Tin Soldier, and other Anderson's characters are interpreted as architectural symbols of resilience by Lego to provide housing, energy, and education for the women and their children. The settlement is partially constructed before we came. First, the Lego factory surrounding the old city is constructed way before the sea level rise. Then, as the water comes, the floating circulation platforms and the public functions are constructed jointly by the Danish government and the Lego group. You can see that the components and the floating platforms are constructed in modular components. Metaphorically, there are steps and shapes like the Lego toys. Before starting to build our own residential community, we first looked at the blueprints of the tectonic construction. This is the blueprint of the ice accommodation, the Ugly Duckling's residence, which is an oil diesel ship inspired by our traditional igloo housing. Thousands of ships will be docked along the underwater warehouses. Each of them provides a comfortable living space for a family. This will be the ship that I drive to Greenland in summer. Well, as I have thought before, I always doubt the Danes' true intention on the ice delivery. Why would they use the polluting diesel ship when they're trying to save the ice sheets? Also, the location of the toilets with the anaerobic digester is highlighted at the tail to show off the Danes' environmental awareness. Ha, how hypocritical. Each community has their own Anderson's ice storage castle, which is influenced by the dreamlike quality from Anderson's tale. Therefore, it appears to be a combination of the famous Odin's castles and gardens on top of a massive floating iceberg. The harvested ice blocks are transported into the mechanically ventilated storage using the trawler. Ha! Imagine the amount of energy it consumes. Even the facade of the storage is made with ice cladding. Every summer, each of these will be dragged to Greenland by 4 to 5 igloo ships. Each community has their own food storage, the Princess and the Pickles. The food storage references the 20 layers of mattresses in the tale Princess and the Pea, while the mattresses here are layers of pickles piled up in the postal bed structure, a great way to show off the organic fresh produce we grow during summer. Every bit of the residential communities are built by us. First, we are to build our own mobile home. With the help of my girlfriends, we lay down the ice facades block by block. We have also foreseen the construction of the ice storage and engaged in building the food storages and the drying fish rack, a signature Greenlandic tradition. The two swimming plans shows that the main program in the project differs seasonally. In winter, I harvest ice with my other colleagues on the floating fuel grids, like the people in the Horror Bean Ice Festival. While in summer, my colleagues will harvest organic crops in the same modules. The community of swans are bounded by numerous ships inhabited by us, while the dark red tone shows the underwater warehouses that now serve the communication and spaces. The public square has referenced the silhouette of Anderson's figure. I usually get up at 7 when the sun rays shine through the ventilating hose on the ice wall. Disco, my husky dog, will also get up with me to prepare for the day. Despite its size, the ship has all the essentials sufficient for my family. As I leave my ship quietly for breakfast, I will take my ice harvesting tools with me and head towards the communal kitchen. On my way, I will grab a piece of dried fish, which the Danes truly despise. There, I will enjoy my traditional Greenlandic soup with my girlfriends and read the news. Oh, the Danes are really enjoying the fruit of a hard labor. Despite the exploitation, this life is nonetheless much more beneficial to me and my family. Then, off I go to my workplace, the Little Match Girls, Ice and Pig Farm. Ice and pig farming are operated side by side every day during winter, a good way to achieve carbon offsets. The blueprint of the Little Match Girls Resilience Farm. The ending of the match girl is twisted. The girl's last match will not go off. She embraces the cold and produces ice in winter. On the left side, it is a four-story pig farms, while on the right, the mechanically freezing mechanism enables us to harvest ice whole winter. I wonder why they're farming more pigs than ice? The silhouette of the little mesh girl, a symbol of resilience, houses both the pig and ice harvesting farms, where we rapidly engage in ice production during winter. Once harvested, the ice blocks will be delivered to the ice storages through husky sledding. This is a depiction of my daily routine. I will first turn on the water pump to draw water in. Then I will change the temperature to -5 degrees to stop the freezing. All these are supported by the tidal energy harvesting machine below the Lego ice mold. When the ice is formed, my colleagues and I will use our traditional tools to slash and clamp the fresh ice cubes onto the slippery corridor. Then the ice blocks will be pushed to the end of the farm where our colleagues will collect. Afterwards, we will turn the match light on to signal our husky transport team to take them to the storage. We busy ourselves in transporting ice blocks into the floating storages. Our girls at the control tower at the ice storage, we use the trawlers to collect the ice. After all the hard work, I usually find my children in the afternoon for skating. The Hugo Garden lights up thousands of Danish candles and the kids are all enjoying. My favorite tea time is a Danish hot dog freshly made every day at the slaughterhouse. As nighttime arrives, we will gather again and enjoy dinner as families and friends. And that sums up my eventful day. The seaweed energy is another highlight of the project. It is an environmental token for Denmark's past wrongdoings and its oil industry. Every 5 weeks, batches of seaweed are harvested and transported to the biofuel generation plant, which references the design of Steadfast Tin Soldier. As it bows down, the wet seaweed will be dried and then processed at the biofuel digestion plant and turned to. The slaughterhouse at the opposite captures and slaughters the fully grown pigs every half year in the notorious pig business. Yet now, the ice production and the organic crop growing is a perfect cover-up for the bad deeds. This is the blueprint of the biofuel plant. Every summer, we spread the message of hope to the rest of the world as we embark on the ice delivering pilgrimage to repair Greenland's fast melting landscape. The community sets sail on the ice pilgrimage to Greenland as the end of spring approaches. The days who remain will continue growing organic crops and enjoying the sun every day. The shipping date has arrived. Before I leave, I will bring my children to the summer school. At school, apart from having fun, they will be taught with knowledge and skills of growing organically. In your organic farm modules, the children will help to collect fresh produce to the pickle food storage. The Olaluki on Summer Dream School takes the blueprints of the umbrella held by the mythical character, which offers children fantastical dreams at night. In the summer school, it will do similar. Each structure. The Danes, on the other hand, are chilling on top of the storages. Every once in a while, the children are taken to the preserved old town where important landscape. The ice Lego factory is essentially a city wall made with ice facade, protecting the old city from being flooded from sea level rise. It is inspired by the traditional castle rampart and the ghost of the famous Danish row houses. In winter, the ice blocks will be hung down in front of the sheep piling to form the facade, while in summer, the ice will melt away and pot plants will be placed instead to compose a green facade. The section shows that the deeply rooted sheep pilings are preventing the water to flood in, while the hanging system, which is supported by a pontoon, displays the ice blocks in winter and green pot plants in summer. The tin soldier becomes a transport crane to deliver materials and finished toy products. The public square. scheme of seaweed toys is a big success for Lego. Toy sets of Greenlandic castles are also sold worldwide. Then, I set off to my journey to Greenland, the destination of my yearly mission to repair the icebergs. As late spring arrives, we set sail on the ice pilgrimage to Greenland to transport the enormous amount of icebergs in our own residential oil diesel ships. I know that the Danes are exploiting us and using ice production as the environmental token to cover up the pig production. Nevertheless, me and my kids do benefit a lot from this new life. I feel empowered and much happier than I was in Greenland. The total amount of ice compensated this year will be around 128 km3. That's two-thirds of the amount of ice loss in Greenland every year. After docking, we start the ice patching work to restore the mountain landscape. In the end, what I truly wish is, by saving myself and my family, I help to save the world.
That's Karen. She was awarded a medal, the Bartlett medal this year. And I'll show you one, the final one before we go on to the Instagram, is Deng's project, Xiao Liang Deng. And this one here is completely different in its format. It doesn't have any narration, no animation, nothing. And it didn't, he wanted to project serenity, peace, and quiet. So I probably will be a very bad substitute. And the portfolio was supposed to be read in peace, in a slow pace. The project, the thesis is all about reincarnation in various guises and forms. The title of the project itself is The Garden of Heavenly Enlightenment. It was started with this called the Tree of Life is not science, but a nuanced art form of reincarnation. It's on the Isle of Thanet, which faces sea level rise. Around the Isle, the spiritual journey of earthly repent establishes a commitment to recycling, a process mirroring the ancient belief in life as a repetitive cycle that Nietzsche revived in the concept of eternal recurrence. These are the seven points on the Isle of his intervention. And the starting point, the first point, is also the last point, to emphasize the concept of recurrence. This, the existing framework here, there's a remains of a bell tower, remains of a church because of the sea level rise, this abandoned small airport landing strip, and then on this side here is the White Cliff, which has been constantly eroded by waves and tide. So another form of recurrence. And then here in the estuary, there's tide going in and out. That's, you know, that's also a daily recurrence. So the notion of recurrence is not just conceptual, but it really exists on the site itself. I'm sure Dan would prefer me not to narrate his project, but the thing is that Dan got a distinction. It was wonderfully well received, and he got the second highest mark in the year. But the thing is that I think for the purpose of this session, I think I need to quickly tell you because we don't have enough time, and I'm going to skip through it quite quickly. The project starts with William Blake's definition of art and science and his view on life and death, and that it's our human right to decide one's own death. And these are the pages of his investigation about this painting in particular, the red dragon and the woman clothed with the sun. William Blake was a very religious man. The project is not designing for euthanasia, it presents an alternative interpretation of the relationship between life and death, and of course, afterlife. And then these are the five locations of possible sites, apart from the Isle of Thanet, which is here. The vignettes on the Isle of Tenet adapt all values of Christianity into a new universal faith of atonement towards nature. And these are the seven narratives that he adopted from Christianity into the new atonement. The vignettes provide an experiential journey of life and afterlife to evoke our contemplation of materialization and repent. And the book that was really influential in this project is from David Mitchell's Cloud Atlas. In the film, it says, "I believe death is only a window. One closes, another opens. If we were to imagine heaven, I would imagine a window opening, and he, God, would be waiting for me there." And these were the sort of four principles of the design strategy. The first one is the ruined clock tower. And here in front of the clock tower here, this is the memorial hall. And as you can see here, everything above in black and white is reality, and everything that's reflected in water, which is the main canvas for his project, would be heaven itself. And everything is recycled. The seats in the memorial hall is constructed by old bathtubs and old chairs. The clock tower itself is covered in soot, in carbon. It also is symbolism of a statement against sort of capitalism, consumerism, and the carbon footprint that we all attribute to. And the ceiling, the enclosure of the memorial hall, is not a physical construct, but one of steam from recycled kettles boiling water to create this sort of intangible, ephemeral, temporal existence of a building. These pieces here are the recycle farm, where people would bring their recyclable personal belongings and deposit it on here. So, and each of them will be accompanied by the very upright, very confident and pride of the cypress tree. So domestic furnishing bearing personal memories, including windows, chairs, bathtubs, bed frames, and curtains, alongside planting carbon banking trees and rewilding of other plant forms, provide profound construction resources. So these are his the manual, including one of how you paint soot carbon onto existing ruins and buildings as a form of a social environmental statement. And the church choir, the memorial hall, will have the sound of the ripples and the waves creating the choir. The recycled bathtub to create seats in the memorial hall, and the creation of the cloud-making kettles. This is the reception, and later on, by the time you finish your journey, it will become the crematorium. So it has a double role. Like in the film, those who have seen The Cloud Atlas or read the book, for example, Tom Hanks in there, he would play a different role, and has no, it doesn't matter. They would be playing either, the characters within, the actors would be playing male and female of different ethnic and also have different characters. They play different characters. Like death, the flood destroys the existing environment, including the church, but reforms the church with a new faith of sustainability. So this is a church which is flooded and becomes the water bank. So water is harvested in this garden. As you can see here, reality is the tree without leaves, life, and the reflection in heaven talks about this eternal well-being. And these are structures that harvest dew for water. Instead of pumping the ground that we do in this country, especially in Scotland, where they pump mineral water out from the ground, which is very damaging to the environment. Conscientious interventions display a delicate and temporal relationship with the existing landscape, a reminder of our transitional existence on Earth. This is the runway, the abandoned runway, which is going to be growing wheat. So the notion of wine and bread, breaking, offering wine and bread, which we are all familiar with. And the field, this is the field, and the growing will be done inside tubs itself, bathtubs, so like this one here. And the tub will collect rainwater. So rather than sort of farming with expensive water, you know, it will collect rainwater. And the floating structure itself, the barrels, the structure will become the barrels to make wine out of well berries. Offering of bread and wine against the backdrop of this wheat-covered landing strip. And again, you know, here we recycle chairs to create screens and for storage system. Nature provides protection to the island from the flood. It also provides a transition between death and life. Here, trees of different kinds are planted, from swan cypress to Italian cypress to snowdrops, for different practical and symbolic purpose. Snowdrops, in this country here, we have this flowering plant that comes out just after winter, and they only appear for a very, very, very short time. And they are called snowdrops. They're beautiful, beautiful, pure white flowers. Here, ashes are scattered into the swamp. Individuals are set free to start the journey to heaven in the form of butterflies, the symbolism of reincarnation. The transition occurs in amongst the Italian cypress trees in front of the deer, which symbolizes God. The narrative is a reminder of the use of cypress to protect the living in Noah's Ark. The embankment of the island is transformed into a swamp cypress forest, for its salt resistance and its ability to cope with soil erosion. The existing local dead trees are marked with soot, presenting a silent self-sacrifice defiance. This is the energy harvester from the tide. This is the wall, talk about the White Cliff, which has been carved and choreographed and shaped by the reoccurrence of waves and tide. And so he didn't do anything to it. All he did was to then occupy the spaces by putting a post there for the raft to moor against. And that was all he did, if you can see these. As with karma and the cyclical transmigration of souls, the first vignette, the reception, is also the final vignette, the crematoria. Each urn on the window screen is accompanied by an angel, making reference to Blake's The Woman Clothed with the Sun. The angels are waiting for the souls to take them to the throne of God. At every hour when the clock bell chimes, a soul is embraced in heaven. The snowdrop which arrives early in spring is a metaphor of our temporal relationship on Earth, before passing on to the next phase of life's journey. The project offers a window of enlightenment of life, death, and afterlife in its ambiguous and fluctuating states of reality and belief. Ultimately, it aims to cultivate an rich understanding between humanity and nature. Okay, that's it for that one. And I'm going to unshare screen and maybe take questions. Take requests from any of the Instagram pictures that you fancy me elaborating or techniques that have been used in that. So I will share screen again. So please shout out anybody which project you want me to elaborate from here. This is a point that I would like you to be, this is Karen's project. Are they requests? This is the moment that you can interact with me.
Could we? Hi, by the way.
Would you like to see your name and then ask so all your friends would know who you are?
My name's Callum Coombe. And thank you, by the way, for talking to us today. I've scrolled down. I'm actually looking at my screen, not at you, but it's where we get kind of orange and red. And
is it further down?
Yeah, crown dependency.
Yep, crown dependency. This one.
It's just very beautiful, and there's an interesting use of perspective in it. I was wondering if you could talk to it.
The crown perspective, just to give you a little bit of background here, is that if you can see my screen now, this is the Bridge Isle, and the piece of architecture travels within the British territorial water. This is a project that criticizes the stupidity of Brexit, that we basically, after Brexit, we cannot have workers from Europe coming to our land any longer. And that would jeopardize our national health system completely, because a big proportion of it comes from outside EU, but a big portion of health workers also come from Europe. And if we want to improve our health service, which is not in the best of state, we need to have plan B. And to circumnavigate the immigration law, if there's a building or a city that could move around the British territorial water but doesn't step foot onto land, then it wouldn't break the EU immigration law. So the elderly who needs care would really then board this, like these people here, board the traveling piece of architecture. Their house, which generally a lot of middle class elderly people now, they live in one big house, huge house in some cases, and then there are only one or two persons living there. We also have a huge housing shortage here. So the idea is a win-win for everybody. They would sell the house off, divide it into six apartments for six different families. They would get onto this ship, get healthcare, and then we can also bring in workers from EU who are in the health and care industry. That was that. That's the background to the story. I think this is a popular image that that looks, I think it was a, people seem to like the image. It's very strange. The images that I've been told, that the images that I like, people generally don't like on Instagram. So that shows my bad taste then. this is a drawing that is an exploded drawing. It's a one-point axonometric perspective that explodes the key elements that performs very specific programmatic functions within the building itself. And the building, just for your information, is floating on iceberg. So maybe if they have consulted Vilius, who is a student who did this project, maybe the Titanic wouldn't have sank. So the whole piece, because the whole project started with him investigating and looking into the narrative of Don Quixote, who has a very inflated and disillusional mindset. So here, the disillusional mindset of hubris is also expressed towards the British government of making an iceberg float around the British Isles. So there's a lot of sort of commentary within the project. So it's not just drawing for drawing's sake. And so as you can see, that's that. And this is a combination drawing of the section of the building, the activity in the courtyard that was not presented in many, it was in plan, it just looked like a flat patch. The relationship between outside and inside, and also the relationship, the social and political commentary between the House of Parliament and the building. So this is not the real spatial relationship, for example, between the House of Parliament, the government, and the building itself. It couldn't be further away. But the things that, you know, here the drawing wants to really bring the kind of concern that the project the political criticism towards the government. So hence that you bring that into play here, into the drawing. And then he did a lot of technical investigations. So as I said earlier on, even technical investigations has to be drawn with poetry and precision and emotions within that. So this is some of his technical construction drawings. And we are really quite proud of it. As much as we try to encourage imagination and exploration and speculation, the making of the speculation rail is a very important part of our studio. And we work very closely with environmental engineers and structural engineers. Could we have, is that okay? Have I elaborated it a little bit? Hello?
Yeah, that was really great.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah.
Go on.
I was just going to say, it seems like a common or a fairly common technique, and therefore perhaps you've taught it, but to overlay different perspectives on your screen in the bottom left, it looks like we've got kind of a first point there, and then the sky plane has a different kind of perspective happening as well.
We try to combine different messages. Sometimes the perspective or the image is for an architectural spatial one, sometimes it's a construction one, but a lot of times we feel that even construction drawings like this one here, or a spatial one, also needs to embody some of the social, political, environmental commentary that they, whatever the project is. Yeah.
There seems
it's not just a straight drawing.
Yeah, there seems to be a technique of almost having a bending moment in the construction of some of those drawings. So, like looking at the center one at the bottom there, it seems like there's a kind of like a bend here where we've got one vanishing point for this part of the drawing merged into a lower vanishing point for the back of the drawing, which really gives us this sense of looking almost, you know, so stretching the perspective backwards so that we get such a strong sense of horizon and, you know, almost kind of start to feel the bend in the edge of the limit of perception there.
Yeah.
So it's kind of like doing a panorama with your phone, but doing it inside the model and stitching those views together at a connecting point.
Yeah, yeah. But also in the foreground here, you can see that on deck of this piece of architecture, what people could be doing as well. So there's, you know, so these are the people that are supposed to be, this part at the bottom is as if you're on the piece of architecture on the vessel and looking out to sea.
Mm.
Yeah. stage with me. Come on.
I have a question. I'm Alex. Thank you very much for your discussion so far. It's been really interesting. I'm just looking through the Instagram, and a lot of the projects seem to fall into a utopic or a dystopic vision of the future. I was just wondering whether you see any patterning in kind of the visual techniques that are used between the two. Are there kind of architectural gestures that are used more in utopic visions and dystopic visions?
No, I think if we are talking about architectural representation, the technique and the representation is very much derived from the script itself, from the narrative and the exploration of what they want to describe. So, for example, this one here, again, it talks about, the happy existence of the returning to youth for, again, elderly communities, the third age. And so it's presented with a fairly happy mode. And you can see here, it's again the daily life of an elderly person on this piece of architecture. Here, for example, this Anna worked on this project in Africa, where a commentary was how water and resilient landscape would save people from falling into the trap of human slavery. And although it's a very dark subject and it's a very real and serious subject, she presented it in a fairly optimistic way. Sorry? Hello?
Oh yeah, no, that wasn't me.
Oh, okay, I thought somebody said something.
I think it was just background noise.
So it's very, the mood and emotions of each project and the way it's presented is very much dependent on the author itself. And and then here, this one is a project that talks about a married car, which is the title of Kafka's book. And it's a fairly dystopic criticism about the what we call not land grabbing but property grabbing that's going on in international cities, that you get investors who have never been to the country or the city. They just buy and buy and buy properties and are left empty, and then causing huge rise in property prices, which becomes is everything all right?
I think so. I think we're all muted again, but I think that was just someone's background noise.
Okay, because I thought that someone was having an argument.
No.
Having muting people before when you were presenting, and now having I'm mute to participate.
Okay.
So there is some noise there. So
No worries. I just thought somebody was having an argument because of something I said or something. Okay, so the things that this one here, he purposely chose a black and white, very dystopic sort of set of constructs within the drawing itself, and so that was that. And then this one here, this project, the student is from he's from China, an incredibly talented student, and he basically was looking into cultivating peace in Tibet with. So the things that with the national government and also the local community here, and the whole thing is through an understanding of weather and nature as well. So instead of doing sort of hard line drawings, he actually adopted much of his drawings with this very soft, romantic, idealized version of peace that could be achieved. And I think the drawing is really, really stunningly beautiful. Yet there's a lot of precision in the watercolor that he used. But he accompanied it with some of these technical drawings too. So, there's two phases to it. So it's also to do with representation, as I said, is to do with appropriateness and what information you want to project. and so forth. And yeah, any more requests for me to discuss one more?
Yeah, I just have a follow-up question to
Alex.
Megan.
Hi.
Hey. I was looking at the Christmas in Liverpool example, and on the Instagram, and
this yeah. one.
Yes. Selection of colour, and maybe your personal thoughts on being discriminatory about limiting colour. This really stands out because of the intentional use of, I guess, one shade of colour and then black and white. But yeah, if you could talk to this project, that would be excellent.
Right. Thank you for the request. I'm very happy to talk about it. The student, just a bit of background story also, is that his grandfather actually came over as an immigrant to the UK. And like all immigrants, they land in port cities. And of course, you know, it's almost a very personal project that he did. And so the starting point is that, you know, he came from the quote that it's all, I'm going to get it wrong now. I better read it from there. It's C.S. Lewis' hypothetical question. It's, what if Liverpool is never winter but always Christmas? It's a reverse of Lewis's quote. And so, and the spot of color is what metaphorically he was very precise about representing hope, and hope, you know, in a very subtle and calm way, in the midst of even the architecture, the new architecture proposed for to address racism and also to address sort of ghettoization of cities. He wants come as an optimistic whole that we can all reconcile and we can all exist in a much better condition. The black and white part represents metaphorically there's still a small percentage of negative thoughts that he would still have about would it be possible. So even in the mode of representation in this very simple set of colors and palette, there's meaning in there. And as you can see, the little white dots, they are Christmas. It represents the metaphor of Christmas. So, and it's not real that Liverpool is actually snowing, but it's the hope that it will be Christmas. And Christmas means everybody will come together socially and as a community. That is the project itself. Yeah.